So we're down to the third video, right? And we talked about your, you know, whole journey and how did you go end up writing JavaScript and PHP in the same time, Laravel, and how much of that, you know, the functionalities of Laravel you like, and that's why you're keeping working on it. And then I had, you know, this question is like Vue, you know, it helps you make a single page app, right?
Yep.
And do you think this is important? Do you think that it's important that we, you know, our apps are always are implemented by using SPAs?
Right. So I don't. I'm skeptical of the SPA movement.
Probably that's why I'm asking that question.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So the final piece of my story is I sort of started to realize how my productivity started to decrease. How, you know, for good cause, in some ways, my UIs were more advanced. You know, I could do more things in the front end. So naturally, I would be writing more front end code and my life would get a little bit harder if my apps are more robust. But there was a degree of unnecessary complexity added that just slowed me down as a developer. So I started raising an eyebrow and digging around and figuring out, why is this happening? Why are we all doing this? Is there a better way? Do we need to do this? And some of the conclusions I've come to, I guess here's, I'm going to fast forward and say this is my blanket statement right now. Fat front end or fat back end, not both.
Yeah, I've seen this on a tweet.
You
shared it. What can you explain more?
Yeah, so I think the scenario that I described in the last video of the quintessential Laravel and Vue app, where the backend's Laravel, the front-end's Vue. And I think there's a correspondence here, like Rails and Vue, Rails and React. You could probably draw more Elixir, you know. You can keep doing that. Even Express, Node, you could say a Node backend that you manage, and then a, you know, a React front-end. That there's two fat things. You have your backend layer that's doing a lot of work. You're getting stuff out of the database. You're transforming it. Maybe you have a queue worker. Maybe you're, you know, sending out emails. You have permissions, authorization, all of those things. And then you have a communication layer between that and your front end. And then your front end has its own set of concerns and its own, you know, application. So basically this setup creates a seam in the middle. And so not only do you have twice the code, but you have extra code for the two systems to talk to each other. So basically I started out by saying SPA's bad. All JavaScript front end's bad. Let's go back to a simpler time. See if we can incorporate some of the new stuff. But like step back from this, let's JavaScript all the things. And I've sort of revised my position to realize that a really JavaScript heavy front end can be great if you're not doing a ton of work on your back end as well. And the answer to that would be some sort of commoditized back end service like Firebase. And there's people, there's potentially a trend in this direction. Like, I think we see a trend in this direction.
There's certainly a trend in this direction. Netlify, Diet are trying
Netlify
to go that path.
Now.
With Lambdas, all these kind of, you know.
Exactly. Yeah, all functions. Of these things, componentizing all the functions that a backend does so that the Laravel developer is out of a job, basically, so that all of those things are happening from these
platforms.
BaaS, backend as a service.
Right.
And that makes sense because now the developer is worried about one system again. So if the backend's all commoditized, they're worried about one system. They can write tests that go across the entire stack that they're responsible for. That's huge. Where this middle ground is not good, because if you're a Laravel developer working on a Vue and Laravel app, if you want to fully test a feature, if you're in charge of the full stack, and I have to create a create users page, I have to do the back end of all that functionality and test those API endpoints. Then I have to do the front end of all that functionality and test those interactions or the view component. And maybe I mock out the JSON, right? So like maybe I make a mock in my front end test of an API that my back end serves. But then maybe the back end changes and you have mock drift, so you need contract tests. Or maybe you just say screw it and do Selenium tests around the whole thing. And now your whole test suite is slow to a crawl and brittle. Like that's the hell that I lived in. And I'm trying to sort of preach people out of, like, let's move in one direction. And I think it's valid to move in the backend as a service, which basically Prismic is a backend as a service.
One of the choices, for one aspect, one particular aspect.
Exactly.
But you can go OAuth for, like, OAuth 0 for OAuth and authorization.
OAuth 0, perfect example, yeah. So that way, I think, is valid and productive. And the other way is what I'm exploring, which is a little bit off the beaten path, but going heavy backend and using new tools. There's a tool in the Phoenix community called LiveView that basically uses backend templates, but you write it like JavaScript and it uses WebSockets to go back and forth. We could get into that in a whole other video.
Of course,
yeah. But basically that's what I've been chasing. Like, how do I simplify my workflow? How do I get it back so that I can write a full stack test in PHP and get assurance that my test works in, 100 milliseconds? I can write a factory and have a testing database all set up the way that I used to be really productive. How can I redeem some of that productivity and not have to deal with managing two systems, managing one system? Yeah.
But mostly, like, if you, and I like that, it's I like the way you express it. And I know that the fact that you move in one of the sides.
Yeah.
Basically, you're suggesting that a complexity comes from the fact that we're trying to build both.
Yeah.
And any of the decisions are good decisions, but not having both because all of that testing and the complexity that comes with it. Now, from when, if you go, for instance, to the, you're saying, okay, I'm going front end.
Yeah.
And I want to use services and all of these kind of things. Now, you still have to write a little bit of logic, right?
For sure.
But that's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Right.
And also there is always all the people will be like worrying about the ownership of their code. Basically, if you go for the platform, you have no idea what will happen there.
True. Yeah, that's definitely a big.
Will it always support the functionalities that I want them to support? Will always Auth0 work the way I would like it, or Prismic as a CMS or any other one?
Yep.
What do you think? Is that
Yeah, I mean I'm not generally a person who's concerned with those types of things, I guess, because I think the projects I work on, I've never really worked on something long enough to see, I don't know. I haven't been a developer at a company for 10 years, so I don't really see projects. I've inherited projects that are 10 years old. But I guess what I'm saying is it wouldn't be as much of a concern to me, but I think it's valid that the thing that would be more of a concern to me is that I'm writing to something proprietary.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm integrating with something proprietary, there's something there. But if you're serving me a GraphQL, like GraphQL is a spec. So if you're serving me a GraphQL endpoint,
then you can replace it.
Yeah, so I wouldn't be as worried about that. If my whole system is built around your SDK, I would think twice if it was a big long-term project.
So you're saying you kind of think about how hard it is to replace that service. Basically,
yeah, with Laravel, it's a no-brainer. Laravel is an open-source project, a big community. It's going to keep going, and I just trust in that. And I'm sure I could very easily find that same trust in another back-end ecosystem. So I think it's just a case-by-case thing.
Yeah, absolutely. I think so. I think like you, that's why often like we try to kind of ourselves when we try to choose it, because we do these choices all the time of taking like, should we implement the thing or not? And we go into that kind of thinking, and we talk a lot to the company to understand like, okay, are they thinking about the same thing that we're thinking about?
Yep.
Are they going to be around for quite some time? So yeah, all this. Makes sense. So now, you told me that that's why you think that SPAs are overrated. Basically, you're talking more about that discussion that SPAs are overrated.
Yeah. And I think SPAs are overrated in the sense that, one, it's everybody thinks that there's sort of a, what's the word, zeitgeist? Like this idea that it has to be like, an SPA or it's old-fashioned or something.
Mm-hmm.
I want to destroy that because that's based on nothing but hype.
Yeah.
So I think there's a little bit of a JavaScript zeitgeist in the culture that I'm a part of me wants to dismantle. But I also want to give it credit where credit is due and recognize it for the potential future that it is.
But at least the message that you're running after is like, hey, things should be simple. They should not,
exactly.
That productivity that you lost, you don't want people to lose it. You want people out of that.
Exactly. That loss. Yeah. And so I think there's a huge community of people who are super productive in frameworks like Rails, Laravel, Django, things like this. They're really productive, and I guess I want to empower them to not have to change careers to stay productive. Find ways that you can stay that productive and use the stack that you know and love, that you can just code circles around. And not have to go, split or go whole hog into JavaScript?
Yeah. I fully relate to that. I think, like, for instance, in our user base, I mean, of course, people want to go to component, and I see a lot of advantages of doing components with when you're doing websites, especially like they have sections and they correspond to components, and that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But if someone wants to use just Laravel or Node or Express or anything that only runs on the server, and they can and that experience they can have the you know the good web experience for their website, that's fine.
Yeah.
You don't have to jump into the hype. You need to kind of satisfy the requirements of what you want to produce, right?
Yep.
Mostly.
Yeah, there's something you said there that caught my ear. So components, like I'd mentioned to you off camera that I love components. Everything about them, it's one of those clear programming paradigms that it struck me and it changed me, and I just love it so much, this concept of one thing. It's like this theory of singularity principle, like one thing. It takes data in, it spits something out, you know, whatever that is. And you mentioned that you mention it as if it's exclusive to the front end. And that's something that I want to bring into the back end is why can't we template our back end templates? Why can't they be components? Like we have includes, you know, you can include a PHP file, but why is there not a back end templating framework that has components with props, because props is just one way down. So that's possible on the back end. The only difference would be you wouldn't be managing state, you know? Like I'm actually working on a back end framework called Livewire that it's component based and it does manage state. And that is a potential path for the future. But even just templating, like these principles, these component principles,
right,
you can take with you anywhere.
Yeah, it has been the industry dream for a long time, you know, Legos and components,
yeah,
and why don't we do these things?
Yep.
But I guess we didn't have the technology back then to be able to model these things. And I guess now
that
we're
succeeding,
we didn't see it probably. But a lot of frameworks try to do that since like a long time. Like I know 15 years ago, maybe 10, Microsoft was trying components with server side, and they kind of failed because they wanted absolutely to run it also on the front end, and maybe that's the mistake they did. Like for instance, at Prismic we have slices, and I don't know if you
I'm familiar now.
Yeah,
now you are after the chat.
So, but the same thing, we're trying to see like, okay, maybe data, the model of components can live in the server side and it can be what we call slices because they are components. So yeah, I see. But the example that I'm saying that you don't have to go for the hype, even if components are very, very useful and popular.
Absolutely.
Still, if you don't see the value, which is huge actually in this case, still you can go for something that can produce the good results.
At the end of the day, if you are making a website that works well with HTML and CSS and maybe some JavaScript, what's the difference? You might even be better off
matters.
In some ways, you know. Yeah, that's the end of the day what matters, not the tools you use, you know.
Cool.
Yeah.
Move to the next video.
Next video.
Thank you.